Hi everyone, it's Professor Hall and we are talking about, guess what? Characterization. I realize that I look like a blue ghost right now, but I'm having some issues with my mic and it was either good sound or good lighting. I care more about you being able to hear what I'm saying, so we're going to try this out. So, characterization. We talked about plot and now we are talking about characterization. How do you build your characters? And we'll talk about what goes into a character, some of the things that you can think about and consider as an author, how you can think about character-driven plots, which we talked about a little bit last week. We're going to talk about a little bit again. And then we will go into showing and telling and the difference between indirect and direct characterization and when you need to use those techniques. So let's get started. So a few things go into characterization. When you are thinking about who your character is, sometimes I know some authors who do really intricate character sketches. They want to look at their protagonist or their antagonist in a lot of detail before putting them into their story. I know other people who kind of do just the story first and then they add details to their characters like during a revision or later on. And I know some people who do a little bit of both. They have a distinct character in mind and they make sure that they put those details into the story as they're writing it. So some of the things you can think about when we talk about characterization basically means the way your characters are built or designed, and the details that go into making a character seem real. You don't need to make every character seem real. If you have like 20 characters in a book, does every single one of them need a backstory, which we'll talk about in a minute? No, they do not. But I like to think of good characterization as being basically these things. The way that you're building or designing your character, the details you're using to make them seem realistic or true to life. So the first thing is what your character does, what your character says, what your character thinks and feels, what other people say, think, and feel about them. So what other people, what other characters think or say or do or think about them. That one's kind of interesting. We'll go into each of these in a minute. The basic facts about your character and I'll go into each one of these, but essentially what they look like, their age, their gender, what they do for a living, those kind of things, the basic facts. Your character's backstory, so their history, past, I almost said past deeds, but yeah, their history, their past, however you want to call it, the backstory, things that would add to their motivation for what they're doing now. Motivation is something that is quite important. We'll talk about that in a minute. So these are the essentials. And if you are building a character sketch, you might want to go through all of these things one by one to kind of talk about or think through rather who your character is. So let's take these. I'm going to reorder them a little bit. I'm going to put the basic facts first. Okay. So let's go through each one of these and we will think through a character. And let's call this character Andrea. Okay. So Andrea, does she have a last name? Sure. Tompkins. There we go. Andrea Tompkins. We will underline her so that we can kind of keep her in mind. So what are some basic facts about Andrea? Let's say that Andrea was born, let's say that her age is going to be 38. I don't know why I'm like really thinking about that. I don't know why I want her to be 37, but I do. she's going to be 37. She is, let's talk about her appearance. She has short hair that is highlighted and always perfectly done. Always perfectly done. I don't know quite what that means, but I can kind of picture it. She has brown hair highlighted with blonde. Yes. Streaks. And it's always perfectly done. I feel like she is shorter, petite. Not full sentences, but it doesn't matter, right? We're sketching it out. She's shorter, she's petite, she wears glasses, pencil skirts, blouses. When going to work, but even when not at work, she wears high heels. Now, why is this important? Because certain people, certain types of people always wear high heels, and certain types of people do not. From Andrea, so far, her hair is perfectly done. She is wearing essentially kind of professional attire, at least to work, and she's wearing high heels. So you, even from this little description, you can get the idea that she's somebody who really cares about their appearance, right? And probably puts a lot of effort into it. So that might be part of her story. Maybe that features in someplace. Maybe it starts off with an inciting incident of her going to work in this perfect outfit of a blouse and a pencil skirt and high heels, and she gets splashed with mud by a taxi cab and has to go in and give a presentation covered in mud. Who knows? Poor Andrea. She's having a hard day. So some other basic facts. Let's say she works in an office doing something where she would have to kind of dress up, right? Public relations for a little bit of high pressure here, for government officials. So she does PR for the government, or maybe for government officials who get caught and doing something wrong. And corporations. She puts spins on things. That's what she does. I like her so far. Okay. What I mean by what she does is I mean what she does in the story. Here we're talking about basic facts. She lives in a... Does she live in a penthouse? Does she live in a smaller apartment? I feel like she lives in an apartment. I don't know what kind yet. Andrea lives in an apartment. In the city. She lives in a nice apartment. We can define that kind of later if we get into the setting, but I feel like she's got a little bit of money. She lives in a nice apartment. Okay, so we don't know quite yet what she does in the story. So let's say that this is gonna be, I want to kind of work on my character before I work on my plot. So I want to kind of, I'll just give you some generic stuff that she would do. She's going to be a little bit uptight, at least at the beginning. She's going to be all business and no play. Very little personal life. That's going to be something that she does in the story. It's going to add to some of those plot points later on. I'm not going to say here yet what she says. That'll probably, again, come up through the story. But I'll talk about the way that she talks. Short, clipped sentences. She just wants to get her point across quickly. Let's think about, except when she's doing PR for the press, where she softens up a bit for the cameras. So she kind of gets that that's part of her job. Gives more details and almost seems to her colleagues like a different, warmer person. Maybe they wonder, now we come down to what they say and think and feel about them. Her colleagues wonder if there is a warmer person hiding inside, or if she's the cold-hearted corporate drone she appears to be. I feel like maybe Andrea's gonna fall in love. So maybe there's one man sees through her facade and tries to get more personal, I put it that way. Or get to know her on a more personal level. That sounds less like he's about to harass her. And how does she, sorry, I'll move this one just so we can kind of follow. Okay, so who do we have so far? Andrea Tompkins, 37 years old. I should put single always. I feel like that's going to come up in this story. All right. Short brown hair highlighted with blonde streaks. Always perfectly done. She's petite. She wears glasses, pencil skirts, blouse, and all the time high heels, even when she's going to Walmart, which she would not do. Works in an office doing PR. She's kind of like a corporate machine. She's good at her job. She keeps moving up the corporate ladder. Because of that, she got a little bit of money, lives in a nice apartment in the city. I feel like it has a walk-in closet, and it's mostly white because no kids are coming over. And she's rarely home. She works a lot. The stove in the kitchen has never been used. That's Andrew. I feel like that little detail, I'll change that to oven. I feel like the oven never being used is kind of an important detail. Mostly a white house, the walk-in closet. She cares about her appearance, right? She's going to be uptight, very little personal life. She talks very quickly. Let's get down to business. What do you want? What do you need? Let me go do it. Let me go do my job. And in front of the camera, she's a warm, caring, and she says things like, there have been allegations against the governor. He's quite upset by these, and we're going to be definitely looking into it. He's starting his own investigation, and he's open to any questions. And in the background, she's like, what happened? What did you do? What do you need me to say? Totally two different, totally different personalities. So her colleagues see her as a corporate drone, except for one man who sees through her facade. We have a romantic comedy boiling up here. All right, so what they think and feel. Loves her job, but feels a bit empty sometimes. Like, she's just kind of unfulfilled and stays out of her apartment because when she's there, it feels lonely and isolating. So, now, why is this, it's not what I wanted to do. Why is this part important? Because up to this point, we have this picture of Andrea from our point of view, from her co-worker's point of view, but we don't have her point of view. So having her add, having the, how they kind of think and feel, and having this idea of being a little lonely, unfulfilled, empty, it's giving her depth, okay? If you had just the other stuff, now I could have added depth in one of the other things too, and we'll get to the backstory in a minute, which will give her a little bit more depth too. But there are differences between flat characters and round characters, and I'm sure you've heard those terms before in talking about literature. Sometimes it's not bad to have a flat character, especially if it's not your main character. They might not need to have too many details, right? Like maybe Andrea has a colleague, I'll highlight that in yellow. Let's say that she has a colleague named Kim. And Kim works in the front office with her. She has a desk a couple seats away. And all we know about Kim is that she does not care for Andrea, but at all. And we see Kim in a couple lines here and there. She makes a snarky remark. She goes to sit at her desk. And maybe she's, if this is a book, she's in like two or three chapters, a paragraph each, right? She's a little side character. She doesn't need this kind of depth, right? But if Andrea is going to be our protagonist, we need to know more about her, and you don't want people to feel one note, right? So having a round character with more of these details, putting them in there can really help quite a bit. So what is Andrea's backstory? Let's say that Andrea grew up in rural, in a rural mountainous, that sounds weird. Andrea grew up in a shack in the mountains. Her parents struggled to make ends meet. They fought a lot, and she didn't have any brothers or sisters. She was alone most of her life. The only thing she wanted, sorry, I'll scroll up a little bit, was to leave the town, to get off the mountain, and to make something of herself. Okay, so we're starting to see a little bit of the motivation here. Now, we could add, depending on the type of story, some other details. Maybe her parents did not really treat her well. Maybe they ignored her, neglected her. We don't know. Maybe we would discover that as we write. Maybe we kind of have this background as we're writing and then we go into it. But we start to see a little bit of her motivation. She wanted to leave town, get off the mountain, and make something of herself. So her motivation is going to be, at first at least, Andrea wants to be successful in her career. And to her, success means not just money or notoriety, awards, accolades, etc. Though she does want that too. But also security. She never really felt safe. So she's struggling. They're struggling. You know, we might find out through a conversation, or maybe she goes back home. She never had stable food source. She never knew when they were going to need to borrow from people. Her house had a leaky roof and it would drip on her at night and wake her up. She never knew if her parents were going to actually bring home a paycheck, or if they were going to get fired again, or if they were going to be able to give her money for the field trip, right? And because of that, she never really felt safe or secure. She just wanted to get out of there and go to college and reinvent herself. And maybe that is part of she reinvented herself in college and never talks about her family or her past. That's part of her backstory, okay? So we kind of get a person who maybe at first looks like a stereotype, and then we have this detail and we round them out, we flesh them out, and then we can take all of this information and drop her into a story. So that is kind of what a character-driven story looks like, right? So if we have, I'm going to shrink all this. Jeepers. Sorry. Let me put it in a normal font that you'll still be able to see. Okay, so we have her basic facts. We have kind of, in general, what she does, what she says, or at least the way she talks, what other people think about her, how she thinks and feels, and then her motivation, at least at the beginning of our story. So looking at Andrea, I would say, let me think. Let's say that it is a romance that I'm writing. Okay. So how would Andrea react if someone tried to date her? I almost said woo. They try to woo her. Let's say that it is her colleague, but that she. Okay, so let's say that a colleague is a client. It's a new client, and he is an actor. And she normally doesn't work with actors. She normally works with corporate and government officials. But this actor likes what she said about some scandal and liked how she handled it and wants to hire her. And then he sees that she's different than she first appears, and he kind of tries to get that warm side out of her, and then that romance starts to build. So how is Andrea going to react to this at first? Well, she's probably going to try to stay professional. She might see him as unprofessional, given the fact that she reinvented herself, given the fact that what she really wants is security. Is she going to want to date someone who's an actor? An actor's life is pretty difficult because they don't have a stable paycheck week to week. They have gigs, they have TV or movie that they're doing, and it'll go for, you know, maybe they have a TV show and the pilot runs, but then the series doesn't get picked up. Maybe they have a movie and they're supposed to get part of the box office, and then the box office receipts are not great. So maybe she'd be kind of worried about this. Who is this guy? I don't know him. He's an actor. Maybe because she's been alone, she doesn't trust herself. She doesn't trust him because, is he acting? Is he telling me nice things because that's the kind of person he is? If he is an actor, is he kind of a player? Maybe she would be thinking all of this kind of thing. So maybe we've got a lot of internal conflict, but the character is going to be important in the story, because you could have somebody else who is a totally different character. Let's say Kim at the desk next door. Kim is starstruck and Kim loves actors, and she has watched romantic comedies her entire life. So when an actor comes into her life, she's going to really pursue him. Totally different story. based on that character, right? So the character in this sense is kind of leading that type of action and leading the plot, because it's the setup, but it's the characters making decisions that drive what happens in the story. Okay, we're going to come up with, using kind of this general thing, we're going to come up with another character, and then we'll talk a little bit about direct and indirect characterization using that character. But at least I think you can see from our example with Andrea how you can kind of build a character sketch and then think about how that character might react in different situations, and also how to make her a little bit rounder instead of flatter. So let's say Caleb Jones. All right. My it's getting a little, sorry for the shaking. Let's have him be a little bit older. Let's have him be 72. Relationship status, widowed. That might be pretty important to the story. Appearance. I think that Caleb is going to not kind of be a frail old man. I think he's going to be wiry. Sorry. I think that the word just didn't look right on the page for a minute. He's wiry. He's got, he's wrinkled and white haired, but still in pretty good shape. Looks like maybe he fought in a war and still has some of those muscles. Like he could chop wood if he needed to. If that makes sense, if you guys kind of picture that. Okay. Where does he work? He's retired, but does a lot of projects around his house and yard. I feel like that might be important. Does he work part-time? Like to keep himself up? No, I think he doesn't. I think he doesn't, because I'm going to say that one of his dislikes is people telling him what to do. And what is he retired from? I feel like, for goodness sakes, I know it's not a full sentence, so it's telling me I don't need the comma, but these are like notes, right? Let's say he's retired from the police force, and he feels like, there we go, he feels like, I had to take orders from the captain for 25 years, and now nobody's going to tell me what to do. I feel like that's Caleb. Okay, so where does he live? He lives in a suburb, in a house that he bought when it was a bit run down, after his wife, Mary, died. Now it's improved. He's thinking about flipping it and buying another house. Big yard, shed on the property. I feel like he's got to have that to keep all his tools. He putters. He likes to putter around. What is he like? Puttering around. What I mean by that is, if you don't use that phrase, like doing little home projects. I'm gonna fix the electrical in this room. This light's not working quite right, and I think I'm gonna try planting some tomatoes this year, and maybe I'll add an addition or a deck. He likes to do that kind of stuff. Dislikes, people telling him what to do, and cats. What he does. We kind of have a little bit of that in up here, but he grumps. I'll put this in what he says, I guess. He kind of grumps at people. He's going to be just in general, just personality traits I don't have in here, but I guess I should. I'll change what he does because I think that would come up in the plot. So we'll take that out and we'll just say general personality. He's curmudgeonly. Meaning he's grumpy and annoyed a lot of the time. He's curmudgeonly. He's stubborn. He likes to do things on his own way. I feel like that's him. I feel like the name's wrong, but we can come back to that later. I don't feel like Caleb would be doing these things, but maybe John. John Jones. John Jacob. John Jacob Jones. And people call him JJ. People called him JJ when he was younger. People don't know. Now they call him Angry Mr. Jones. Or Mean Mr. Jones. Which I guess is what we can say about other people. People used to call him JJ when he was younger. And probably, to be fair to him, before his wife died. When he was on the force. It was JJ and then Officer Jones and then Lieutenant Jones. Now it's Old Man Jones. People used to respect him. Now the neighborhood kids kind of, whoops, sorry guys, laugh at him a bit, make fun of him. He doesn't get any respect now. He used to, though. What he thinks and feels, I think, unlike our last example, JJ or Old Man Jones, he feels good about his life and his choices. He's kind of done with society. Just wants to be left alone. And he just wants to do his own thing. And he's okay with that. He's not, I mean, you know, misses his wife every now and then. But for the most part, she nagged him a lot. And now he just watches what shows he wants to watch. And he does the projects he wants to do. And he's okay. He's okay with the life he has. So what's his motivation might depend on what happens. This is the kind of thing, a lot of times I don't do this intricate of a character sketch. What I kind of will ask is a question like this. So I'm going to leave motivation blank for a minute, but I'll have an essential question. So what I'm thinking right now is, how would a man like John Jacob Jones, how would a man like this react if there were a zombie apocalypse? If I can spell that. Oh, I did. Nice. Good for me. As the helicopter's going overhead and I may or may not have been watching certain things on Netflix. Yeah. How would a guy like this react if there were a zombie apocalypse? I think his motivation ultimately is going to be survival. think this guy is a tough, grizzled old guy, right? And he is going to want to survive. He's seen some stuff in his life being on the police force. He is older, and he is not going to put up with these freaking zombies trying to take over his tomato garden that he's been working hard on. And they're sure not as heck going to get into his shed. So, I should put a question mark here. How would he react? His motivation is going to be survival. Now, the question is, that kind of comes after this, is he going to team up with a group of people, or at least another person, in order to survive? If so, is he a leader? Is he a kind of antagonist in the group? Is he going to help them learn some survival skills? I don't know. Let's go back to his, do we have his backstory in here yet? No, we don't. Okay. So, some of the backstory of this guy. He looks like he fought in a war. Did he? Maybe. If we're going to do zombie apocalypse, we have a guy who was a police chief, maybe before, or a lieutenant at least. Before that, was he taking orders from drill sergeants? And that's part of that personality. Part of, he's very, I want to say up here, personality. Disciplined. He's very disciplined. He's stubborn, but he's disciplined. So now he's in a freaking zombie apocalypse with millennials, heaven forbid, and Zoomers, Gen Zers, and probably some people like me who are very apathetic Gen Xers, and he's got to deal with this nonsense. I think that that's part of it. So which war would that have been? Now, going by his age, probably Vietnam, but I want to say, I feel like he's Korea War, but no, you know what? I think Vietnam fits here, because if we're doing zombie apocalypse, Vietnam, it was like a war that didn't have any rules. A lot of times people didn't know they were shooting at. It's hard to tell who the enemy is because people on your side are from the same country, right? It's essentially a civil war we got involved in. It was very hectic. You had to hide in the, the jungle and all that. So yeah, part of his story is that he served in Vietnam. And I'm going to say he enlisted of his own free will. That's important because some people in Vietnam were drafted. JJ didn't want to be drafted. He wanted to go. And not only that, he signed up at 17 with a fake ID. So went a year early. That's JJ. That's JJ. Maybe we find out more about that backstory as he's fighting the zombies. Maybe you find out how he helped rescue part of his team. Or maybe he doesn't like working with a team because he saw so many people die out there, right? That kind of thing. So, yeah, how is he going to react? As I kind of think about, this is a lot of times, this is kind of how I start a story. How would a guy who's an older, stubborn old man react if there were a zombie apocalypse and the only people around him are kind of softer suburbanites who are used to being on their devices all day? Is he going to team up with them? Is he going to lead them? Is he going to be kind of rough with them to get them through the apocalypse? To save them from the zombies? Is he going to encounter a situation where he's kind of forced to help? Maybe he wants to do it on his own for a bit, and somebody comes up to his door and is like, they're about to get me! And then he has to let that person in, but his house is really fortified now, and that kind of thing. But now he's got this kid that he's got to help, and he sees that this kid is soft, maybe like he was before he went to Nam. That's kind of how I think out a story. And as I'm just kind of thinking about it here. with our example. So let's say before the apocalypse, we have a scene with Mr. Jones. So here I'm going to use direct characterization. So direct characterization means essentially that I am telling the reader something about the character. Okay, I'll be a little bit more directly. Directly telling the reader something about the character. So I'm going to give you two examples and I'll talk about which one I would do and which one I would not do. So here is, if you remember from the sketch, John Jacob Jones, or Old Man Jones, or Mean Old Man Jones, as he was known by the children in his neighborhood, hated cats. Okay. Little bit of backstory about his name, but essentially we could have just had John Jones hated cats, or John hated cats, or Mr. Jones. But this idea that he hates cats is an example of direct characterization. I had that in his dislikes up above, and the fact that he hates cats, maybe this is how I start the story. John Jacob Jones, or Old Man Jones, or Mean Old Man Jones, as he was known by the children in his neighborhood, hated cats. Directly telling you what he feel, how he feels about these animals. Okay. Another example, when he was just 17 years old, Mr. Jones signed up as an enlisted jeepers. Let me change this. When he was just 17 years old, John Jones voluntarily signed up for the Vietnam War. He used his older brother's license to do so. And it was easy. Especially since his older brother dodged the draft and fled to Canada. When John came back, he mailed his brother license, but didn't talk to him for 5 years. Now, it's not exactly, there's a little bit of indirect there, but we'll talk about that in a minute. But we have, when he was just 17 years old, he voluntarily signed up for the Vietnam War. I am making this up as I go, so it's not the best writing, but yeah. So both of these are telling the audience some information. So you could do these directly. Old Man Jones hates cats. You can do when he was just 17, he signed up for the war. If you were doing indirect characterization, I'll highlight a little bit here in blue. John mailing his brother the license and not talking to him for 5 years. What does that say about his character? This is indirect characterization. So indirect characterization occurs when we are showing characters, words, actions, etc., show their personality traits. That's essentially, it's the essential the essential definition. So, direct characterization, the author directly tells the reader or shows, tells the reader something about the character. Indirect, essentially, the author is indirectly showing something about the character. So the words, the actions do the talking for them, right? So I'll give you one more example here. Instead of saying Mr. Jones hates cats, let's say every morning when John Jacob Jones woke up, he would get a cup of coffee, throw on a robe, open the front door to get his newspaper. Not many people do that nowadays, but John Jacob Jones or JJ or Old Man Jones, he only reads the paper. He doesn't read any of that online crap, right? He doesn't have a computer. I should have added that. I don't think this guy has a computer. And at least 3 times a week, he would grab a broom and swiftly sweep his neighbor's cat off his front doorstep. Once or twice, he was tempted to kick the cat, who seemed to like his doorstep more than who seemed to like John's doorstep more than his own. We'll say her own, just so it's not as confusing. More than her own. No matter how many times John screamed at her to go home. Okay, we've got a little bit, let me shrink this down so we can see it kind of all together here. There we go. Okay, so here, indirectly, I'm showing you that he does not like this. He doesn't like cats, or at least he doesn't like this cat. He's hitting the cat with a broom. He's tempted to kick the cat. He is screaming at the cat to go home, right? That is a way of showing rather than just saying. Now, what some people will do is say, John Jones hated cats. Okay, now we have the direct. But do we need that? No, we sure do not. Oops. And my strike through is not working. Okay. There we go. We don't need that sentence. And you don't need it at the beginning either. I mean, you can. You could start it out that way. John Jones hated cats. Every morning when he woke up, he'd get a cup of coffee, etc. But you don't need the direct in that sense. You could just have the indirect. Now, going to our second example, when he was 17 years old, he voluntarily signed up for the Vietnam War. In this case, I don't think it's the worst thing to just tell your reader. And a lot of information and other professors and other authors will say you need to have indirect characterization all the time. But sometimes that's just not true. If you're writing a short story, you might not have time to show that scene. If you were writing a book, you might really not want to show that scene. Maybe we have some details that are hidden. Maybe it's a first person story and John Jones doesn't want to talk about his time in Vietnam because it was difficult. And maybe he just says things like, this is kind of like when I was in Nam. That would be a little bit indirect, but maybe your reader just needs to know up front, he signed up for the Vietnam War voluntarily at a young age. So it's not that bad to have a a statement like that once in a while. But if it comes to something like he hated cats, if you can show that very briefly, that would be great. So if you think about that first story we read, week one, the fat queen, that was all direct characterization. She was fat. She ate too much. Her husband wanted to please her. He made everybody eat too much food, and then they all got fat, right? Very direct, and it really didn't work. But you can have direct sometimes, and you certainly can have a mixture. What I would like you to think about as you're writing, what I'd like you to take away, making those round characters, taking people beyond just the flat basic traits, taking them beyond an archetype or a stereotype, things like, you know, the beautiful queen, the wicked evil witch, the uptight office worker, like with Andrea that we looked at, the curmudgeonly old man, like we saw with Mr. Jones, taking that a step further, giving a little bit of backstory, giving a little bit of detail, and thinking out things like, you know, how does the character, where the character lives, how does that affect their personality? How does the way that they dress show their personality? What things might they like or dislike that might come up in the story that might affect things or might not affect things? Maybe Mr. Jones really loves cherry pie, and that is his favorite dessert, and that's just part of who he is. It's not necessarily a huge plot point, but that just gives you a little bit of detail, makes him feel more like a real person. Maybe his wife always made him chicken and biscuits, and that is something that with the zombies attack, he misses, and he starts thinking about her and how maybe he was harsh on her, and maybe she nagged him for a reason, right? You can think about all of those things. So when you're writing, you know, you can do a character sketch and think all those things through. You can have just one line. As I said before, I'm going to talk in a couple weeks about a book I wrote called Smothered, and the premise for that was what would happen if a girl who was a child star was murdered and her sister was kind of homely and nobody really paid attention to her. That's not a huge part. I mean, it is a huge part of the book. It's not the only plot line and she's not the only character, but that was kind of how I thought of her having a sibling. Like, what if she had a sister who's a couple years older and nobody pays attention to her and everybody gives this child star all the attention in the world? How would that affect her sister, and especially how would her sister be affected maybe having some survivor guilt of being the child that lived, even though she wasn't the child that was necessarily wanted at first or paid attention to at first. Then sometimes that's kind of all you need, and you can go with your plot from there. Other times, you might want to think about your protagonist and your antagonist and do this character sketch and think about how they're going to interact and what might come about for them, or how they might, their personality traits might affect the plot. And certainly you can consider a plot that maybe has been done before, like we looked at a kind of like romantic comedy. How can you have some characters that give that a little bit of depth and a little bit of difference, and how can you make that a character-driven story as opposed to just having like the standard like meet cute, misunderstanding, verbal sparring, and date night, falling in love, right? Those are the essential plot points, but can you have that be more character-driven? So those are some of the things I'd like you to think about this week, and I hope that you learned something from this discussion. Thanks, everyone.